You call yourself an artist. On what ground? Drown, baby, drown.
Download the One Page Spotlight app for artists.
Hey everyone. Hi Sanket. Hello Maitri. Hi Ajmal. Welcome to this session on translation. The session is titled Translation as an Art. So the first question is probably the most obvious question. What brought us to this point where we have come together and we are discussing translation? What has our journey as a translator been? So I'll start with Ajmal. Would you like to share your thoughts? How did you start translating? Because writing original literature is so much more lucrative. How did it all happen?
Well, actually, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to look at my life. So, actually, a better way to express this would be translation as a way of life, because as a young boy, I was forced by my father to study engineering, which I didn't have my heart in. And so from the time I finished, I had developed the habit of reading literature, and I remained jobless after that for about 2 years. So I decided to bring out a journal in Urdu. So I worked in Urdu mostly. So that journal was started in 1981, as soon as I finished my engineering education. So for that, I wanted to include a lot of stuff from other languages. So I decided to have a section on Borges, who I had recently discovered. I was, 22 at that time. So I contacted some Urdu writers, fiction writers who were also who claimed to be translators. So I distributed the stories to them, but none of them except one did the translation. So I decided to do all the translations myself. So this is how I wanted to punish them with bad translations, but they turned out to be adequate. So this is how I started. And the idea of translation is to share your reading with your friends. So if you read something in another language, you, first of all, you want to spend some time with it. So if you translate it, you pass through the whole text as if you are recreating it. So that is the, I think that is the best joy of reading. And then you share it with people. So this is how it started. And then I, the next thing I translated was a Persian novel, Sadiq Hidayat's Bufekur, The Blind Owl. So I had read it in English, and it was a very haunting text. So I wanted to fight with it, and I wanted to come out of its negative influence. So I decided to translate it. I found the Persian original, and then with the help of the English translation and Parchin, I rendered it into Urdu, which was the beginning of actually the collaborative translation, because I felt that many of the things that I wanted to translate or wanted others to translate into Urdu were actually English translations of Latin American literature or Indian literature or European literature. So English has always worked as a middle language, intermediate language. So I have always considered this kind of translation a collaborative translation, but then I moved to actual collaboration. So when I translated a Marathi novel, for example, into Urdu with the help of my girlfriend who was from India and who had Marathi as her language, she had given me that novel, Hamid Dalwai's Indhan, in Dilip Chitre's translation, English translation. So we wanted to meet, and we were not getting the visa to each other's countries between India and Pakistan, you know that. So we decided to meet in Nepal, and she brought the Marathi original and also the Hindi translation, and I had the English translation. So we did that collaborative translation into Urdu. So that was first, and then I visited India in 1982, and at the end of my journey, it was a three month long journey. At the end of it, I was in Bombay, and I had met a wonderful person called Girish Damania, who was a Gujarati speaking person, but he was very, very well read in English and Urdu and Hindi and Gujarati. So with him, I translated two Gujarati poets, Suresh Joshi and Ghulam Ahmad Sheikh, into Urdu. So that was also a collaboration. So I have always looked at this activity as a collaborative effort. So I think this, then I started that journal as a regular quarterly in 1989. And in last year, I published four issues of it together, which was from 101 to 113. It was 1600 pages. So that was my way of fighting the lockdown. So I have always looked at translation as a process of reaching out to others and to know the other culture, the other sensibility, in order to know myself better and my own culture and my own surroundings. So this is which is why I feel that this should be called a way of life rather than an art. Living life is also some kind of an art. So this is how, and I think for the future, this we are stuck with this pandemic right now, and that gives us a big opportunity, because I'm thinking of, for example, requesting my friends to make such collaborations, and over Zoom they can translate books. For example, there was a plan that I and Maitri had made to translate a Kannada novel simultaneously into English and Urdu, with the basically she was supposed to help me. I didn't know Kannada at all, but that didn't happen. But I think this kind of collaboration can happen now, thanks to Zoom and thanks to the pandemic. People can work on literary texts and experience this, rendering it into two languages at the same time together. So that would be a very enriching experience, and I can tell from my own experience so far. So this is it.
Thank you, Ajmalji. I think all our work put together wouldn't match up to the amount of work that you have done, given your experience and your...
Yeah, I've been around for some time.
We just hope we also get to live a productive and meaningful life like the way you have lived. So we hope that at your age we can also speak with some pride that we have done something with our life. So yeah, thank you so much. Sanket, would you like to share next your journey as a translator? What made you a translator? What brought you to this?
Sure. So there are two things that were happening. And while Ajmal Saab was talking about his life, the thought that really struck me was the fact that translation is a way of reaching out to others. It's a way of building a bridge. So I've always thought of translation as that sort of a bridge that just does not talk about poetry but transcends beyond poetry. It talks about bridging the gap between two cultures. It's obviously it is an art, but it's not just an art. It's an art where you have to minus yourself from your own text, and you have to show the text of someone else. So if I really put it in a nutshell, I'm always exposed to poetry of different languages that was happening around me. Obviously, because I'm from Mumbai, there are Mumbai is obviously a melting pot of multiple languages. So if I was having a Marathi Kavi Sammelan somewhere, there was a Hindi Kavi Sammelan happening somewhere nearby. There was a Urdu Mushaira happening somewhere. There was English poetry reading happening somewhere. Somebody was translating French to English. Somebody was translating German to English. So I was always, surrounded by all of these stimulus around me. And I just kept on soaking from one stimuli to the other. What it really did for me as a poet first is the fact that it enriched me from within. So, today, if you ask me what exactly does translation do, translation tells you how and where does your language fall short, and where does your language give you much more than what other languages can give you. And at the same time, it also tells you what other languages are giving you, what your language cannot. And that sort, it kind of fills you up from within. It kind of enriches you as a poet as you go along, because it's not just about translating a particular text. You translate the history of feeling of that particular poet, whatever he was thinking. So what really happened in my case was, because I was, always involved with all multilingual activities taking place around me, there's this one landmark festival that took place 3 to 4 years back. It was known as Poets Translating Poets, and it was undertaken by Goethe Institute, Max Müller Bhavan, and it was a global event where a lot of poets from different countries and from multiple Indian states came to Mumbai. And the occasion was because all of these poets were being translated by Indian poets, and Indian poetry was translated by all of these world and global poets. I think this is for the first time when I realized that, poets do live an absolutely dignified life, that there are amazing poets around, that all of these poets, while doing their day jobs or while, being in the physical world of earning money, are doing something truly phenomenal, by translating a different language, translating or going beyond their own frontiers of language, and collaborating with poets of different languages. So for the first time, I kind of saw all of this, and I was completely mesmerized with the way people were translating each other's texts, with a sort of endearment that they were talking about each other and, the poetry that they have written so far. And that kind of made me think, and I decided to kind of explore multilingualism. So I started a program called Crossover Poems. It still goes on. And that basically is a multilingual setup where I generally bring one Urdu poet, one Marathi poet, one Hindi poet, and you know, one maybe a Bangla poet or a Tamil poet. And I generally try to have you know, a multicultural poetry reading recitation session where all of these poets kind of come together and they share their ideas. And that for me became a breakthrough, because here, you know, I could actually witness four different languages and actually see what each language does to the audience and what each language does to the poet and what does each poet take home with them. And that itself was a wonderful experiment. And then after that, I started doing a lot of translations. So then I took up Rochelle Kotker's English poetry. I started translating that. I started exchanging, you know, my poems with a lot of English poets, and I started writing a lot of articles about English poetry, Hindi poetry. And that's when I started understanding the nuances that each and every language gives us. Truly, it is just the way Ajmal Sahab said, it's a way of connecting. But what I truly think is, you're not just translating a poem. You're basically translating the culture of that poem. You're basically translating the texture of that poem. You're basically translating your love for that particular piece of poetry. And that's the reason why it makes all the difference. So while your question stands true that, hey, writing your own stuff is so lucrative and things like that, why do you turn to translation? The reason why you turn to translation is because after a point of time and after you start writing your own voice, you definitely feel the need for, you know, finding out more other voices like you. I think the entire process of translation is basically a process of falling in love with a particular poem, with a particular ideal that that poem or that poetry brings about. And then to kind of, you know, then it kind of translates into your own words and your own text. So that's what I truly think.
Thank you, Sanket. I think the idea that it enriches us as a poet, the very act of translating, of course, there is a much larger societal value to it. The language barriers getting broken, cultural True. Connections, reaching out. But at the end of the day, it also enriches us, something that I think all of us have felt.
You call yourself an artist. On what ground? Drown, baby, drown. Download the one-page Spotlight app for artists.
Maitri, you are a prolific writer. Your new book, Sylvia, is also out and you have also been translating for a long time. So what are your thoughts? Because I think you balance your own writing and translating in a very good way. So
Sort of one thing I'd like to say, you know, you started off with saying writing your own stuff is lucrative. I don't think it is, you know, and anyone who writes for the sake of making a lucrative business of it is not a writer, is a business, really. And if they end up writing good stuff, it's just coincidence. Anyone with any deep love for writing, literature, reading, translation, just does it for the love of it. So that way, translation is no different from writing your own stuff. It's just because you are in love with the text. When you're writing your own thing, you're in love with an idea, and that you explore through words, which is pretty much what you're doing in translation. Here, the idea has been given to you by the original text. I think that is the only difference. I don't see it as being apart. And, you know, I really fear having to use cliches here. Sometimes all these big, grand things that people say, I didn't write it, it wrote itself, and, you know, I didn't choose it, it chose me. But I mean, cliches apart, but I do believe in the value of these things, you know. When it comes to translation, I say, I didn't choose it, it chose me. For all of us here, being from the subcontinent, we have this big advantage. Most of us are bilingual, if not, you know, multilingual. Bilingual is probably the least one is. There's always a mother tongue. Most often than not, you come from a different state and you're living in a different state. So there is what you speak at home, there's what you speak outside of of the home, and there's always English, there is Hindi most often than not. So that way we are mostly conversant, and when we switch between languages, we are switching between cultures, and that is happening automatically. So I think whether or not we're conscious of it, we're all translators in one way. And to take it up with literature is a choice that you do because, you know, you love literature. So that way, the way it began for me is, you know, it was quite accidental. I was doing my master's in Hyderabad, UFL University, and I was part of this course called Indian Cinema of the 1950s. So we were looking at using the lens of cinema to look at society and history and politics of that time, that decade in Indian history. And for that, we were watching films from every Indian language and with subtitles, of course. And then we would discuss it and we would read some film theory around it. And it was a very interesting course. So we had watched, you know, Marathi films, Tamil films, lots of Malayalam films, Bengali films, of course, in every language. But the only Kannada film that was part of the course did not have subtitles. And the professor was thinking of dropping the film because others wouldn't understand it. And I said, no, please don't do it. I mean, I know a little bit of linguistic pride came up, and I said, no, I'm going to translate. I'll write the subtitles. Give me a few days. I'll write the subtitles and let's watch it. So I did that. And that's when I just came with the confidence of knowing Kannada, nothing more than that. And I wrote it and it turned out to be interesting. Everyone loved the film and we had a great discussion. But also that intense joy of translation while I was doing subtitles, not even something very deep, like it's not literature, it's not a poem, but just subtitles for a film itself gave me that joy and, you know, confidence. From then on, you know, small things came to me. Somebody asked me to translate a short story to be part of a big anthology or a poem, and it just kept growing. And with that, my confidence, my love for a language also kept growing. And I want to distinguish between translation and publishing. You know, most often they're not, we club it together. We think translation is only work that we publish ultimately and goes out. For me, it is, I mean, I would like to, you know, have a different opinion here. The others said it's about reaching out to others who don't speak your language. For me, it's really reaching within. You know, I don't consider English and Kannada separate. I mean, they're both my languages. And for me, it's intimate reading. When I read a text and translate it, it's engaging with it in a very, very intimate way. So it's really reaching within. And I translate for myself, to be honest. You know, whether or not I publish it later is a different matter. But I just do it for myself because it just gives me so much joy. So I kept doing these small things, a poem that I would pick up and translate for myself. I wouldn't need the poet's permission because I was doing it for myself. There was no question of publishing it. But once in a while, things also got published, and that helped me kind of get more access. Somebody had commissioned an essay by a professor, H. S. Prakash of JNU, for an anthology. And while I was doing it, I had some questions, so I reached out. I contacted him, and he was pleased with my translation, and he asked me if I would do one of his plays. That's how I did this Mante Swami Katha Prasanga, which before signing up for it, I had no idea because it was extremely difficult. It's set in this very tricky kind of dialect. It's a performance play by Dalits of a certain region, very specific region in Karnataka, rural Mysore. So I had to, you know, learn the nuances of it, and it's full of poetry. It's a musical. So each scene is connected with a song. And, you know, doing songs, doing poems is an entirely new experience because not only are you transposing the meaning, you're also transposing the aesthetic quality of that. You know, it has to scan, it has to be sung because you're looking at performance. So all those challenges, and with that, my confidence grew. And then I translated a novel, and here, this was not commissioned. I just wanted to do it because I'd read it and enjoyed it in Kannada. And I asked the author if I may do it, and he said, fine, but, you know, he was not very confident because I was practically unknown. And he said, you want to do it, but publication and everything is your responsibility. I said, okay, I did it. And it was accepted well, so I managed to publish it also, and that's kind of how it's been. And even now, I don't distinguish. In fact, I think my experience as a translator has come in very, very handy for writing my own novel, because, you know, ultimately you're spinning words, you're playing with language, all you have is a small idea, and you know, you let it grow. That's what is happening in translation also. As Sanket said, it's not just the language, it's not just the meaning that you're carrying forward. You're carrying forward an entire culture, and that is a big responsibility on your shoulders. So I think, you know, it's been an incredible journey, and even I wasn't aware where I was going. And right now, I still don't know where I'm headed from here, but it's been beautiful. And, you know, I just want to keep engaging with words for as long as I can. That's the whole idea.
Great, great. So good to know how you have been able to, you know, continue your own writing and translation together, and the way you look at them as a single entity. It's a beautiful view that you have brought together. Let me tell you a little bit about my journey. I started translating around 2011, and it was very, a poem that I like. I ended up translating it. So I ended up translating a couple of K. Sachidanandan's poem, a couple of Qazi Nazrul Islam's poems into Hindi, because the language in which I write is primarily Hindi. And then around 2013, I came across a poet, Shi Lizzy. He was a Foxconn worker in China, and at the age of 23, he had committed suicide. And some of his poems were extremely, sometimes you come across something that you can't help but translate. So that was that moment for me when I read his poetry. Some of his work was so powerful, the struggles of a worker working in a factory where you're not even allowed to go to the bathroom, and working conditions are so difficult. There are punching bags with their manager's faces on it so that they can bring out their anger in their dormitories. That's the working condition they lived in. And I read the Chinese, the Mandarin translations into English, which I translated into Hindi and gave it to a magazine. So they really liked the work and kind of encouraged me to translate more. And I ended up translating a couple of haiku poets in the process. And I really enjoyed this process so much so that I ended up translating three of the the most well-known haiku poets from Japan, poets from 17th and 18th century, Basho, Isa, and Buson. I ended up translating their work and also writing long-form essays, about 30,000 words essays in the form of a book. So what eventually shaped up over the next 5 years, and to write this book, I quit two jobs. So it has been a long journey. I have been working, I worked almost daily to make this book happen. But of course, there were other things also I was doing during that time. But when this book happened, I realized that I feel so much more enriched as a poet. Exactly what Sanket said, that, you know, it really enriches us as a poet. Translating the Japanese poetry into Hindi was a journey in itself, and writing about them and trying to look at the world from their perspective. There was a point in time where I used to dream of Japan. I had never visited that place, but because I was reading so much of their work, I was seeing Mount Fuji and the 17th century Japanese seashores. I was so much into that world. So it's like stepping into someone else's shoes and walking around the world. And when you translate a great poet like Basho, who can only be compared with the greats like Shakespeare and Tulsidas, and so it really propels you as in your thought process. I really felt that happen with me. There was also a phase around 2014 where I was suffering with not it didn't last for long, but there was a period in my life when I was suffering from clinical depression, where I was not able to write anything. And that is when translation really came to rescue. I started watching some plays on YouTube. I really enjoyed a play by Howard Zinn. He is an American historian, a well-known American historian, who wrote People's History of America, which starts by saying that Saint Columbus is not saint. He was a rapist and a murderer who came into. So it kind of helps the Americans. That book actually started a discourse around, looking at the non-white history of America. So he is a well-known historian, but what is lesser known about him, he also wrote a couple of plays. He wrote three very good plays. One is called Marx in Soho, where Karl Marx has suddenly reached America, contemporary America, and is commenting on it. It's a mono one act. It's a mono play, just one actor who is, saying the entire dialogue. And two more plays. One is called Emma, which is about Emma Goldman, the feminist, 19th century feminist from US, who is also a organizer, a labor movement organizer. And the third play is a very contemporary play where a father-daughter conflict plays out between father is a nuclear scientist and the daughter is a peace activist. So you can see what conflict might play out between them. It's a very nicely written play. So I got really inspired by his writing and I ended up translating his work. And because it was a very different state of mind I was in, I translated all the three plays in just 2 months' time. I could do nothing but just translate. So that happened, and so these are the two books of translations that have come out. And here and there, I have been translating. I really draw a lot of inspiration from the senior Hindi poets. The Mangalesh Dabral recently passed away. He was an avid translator. So I felt that 80s onwards, a lot of poets have actually gone out of their way to translate, which was not something which 60s poets and 70s, during the decade of 70s and 60s, it was happening. Translators are separate and original writers are separate. It was kind of
actually, that. I do have something to share here, because what really happened with Marathi literature, and I can talk about that as well, is the fact that the process and the idea of translation in Marathi literature took root very early. Like, it really took root around the 40s or the 50s. If I do really trace back a lot of Marathi poets, and their inspiration wasn't just, poets from their own languages, but poets from a lot of other languages. So we were very early on, Marathi literature brought Shakespeare into Marathi, brought a lot of Lord Byron, Sylvia Plath, that was all brought into Marathi very, very fast and very early. Mandelstam was kind of translated at least 40 years before. So there was a lot of influx which was happening, the source language into the target language. So that was happening constantly. But the most important part was, because that happened early on, we understood that, hey, listen, there is this poet who, writes in a completely different language, who has a completely different voice, who has a completely different thing to say than what you can ever say. And so it kind of taught us a completely new ideal. So I think, although languages kind of differ, and each language has its own value system and own way of, projecting itself, I think what translation really does is it kind of brings that projection into the other language. And that's really more important.
Yeah, that's a very good point. And Marathi, I think all Indian languages took charge. As in, I think Shakespeare was translated into Hindi also pretty early. In fact, Shakespeare, Russian literature, these are some of the authors who were translated at a very early stage. It is the cross. Now the more contemporary work is getting translated now, which is a great thing that is happening. So I really got inspired by that, and I have been translating. The project that I am currently working on now is, it's called 21 21st Century Poets. So 21st century, we have picked up 21 Hindi poets. It took a lot of time to shortlist, actually. We are still in the process, and we are translating their work into from Hindi into English. So this is a Hindi to English translation, and we are a larger group of team. As Ajmal Saab told, collaborative translation. Now we are actually at that stage where we are starting to work on more collaborative translations. And a commissioned work, which is The Trails Less Traveled. It's about the different trails, the different treks you can take in Himachal Pradesh. So a civil servant who worked there for several decades and is a nature lover, he has written his own memoir where he has taken these treks over decades of time, and he has really written about the culture, the life of people who are living in the Himachal, and the wildlife. So I really got inspired that book, and I chose to translate it as a commission project. So these are a couple of the things I am working on. I think one of the things that I think we should all discuss is our difficulties. What are the difficulties we face as a translator? Ajmal Saab, would you like to share? Because I think you have the most to tell us what we should, you know, for us to learn from.
I was actually guided by two very important things that Borges said. He said that after all, it is rereading that counts. So I consider translation as a rereading, a very intimate reading, as Maitri says. So the other thing is that two languages are not two lists of vocabularies. Two languages are actually two different ways of looking at life and the world. So when you are translating, you are, I have experienced that every translation is a failed translation. So you want to make it work as long as far as it can work. So, but you experience two kinds of difficulties that I have found out. One is the linguistic difficulty, I mean, linguistic distance between the two languages. And the cultural distance. So sometimes the two cultures are quite close to each other, but linguistically they are quite far. For example, when a friend translated the Malayalam writer Vaikom Muhammad Bashir into Urdu, obviously with the help of the English translation. So I found that there is a lot that we can easily understand. I mean, on the meaning side. So the culture is not so very different, but linguistically, of course, there is very little that is common between Malayalam and Urdu. But on the other hand, Persian. So Persian, when linguistically we are very close to Persian, vocabulary wise. So, but culturally, Hindi would be closer to the Urdu culture, or other North Indian languages. So then you have to actually find first of all, feel the essence of a sentence or a story or a work of fiction or poetry, and then try to recreate, reimagine the whole thing into. So I mean, as Maitri says, it is not very different from writing your original stuff, because if you are writing a poem or a story of your own, you are translating something which is in your head, and generally you are not satisfied. You can't say that you have been able to put on paper or the screen as you had imagined it. So original writing is also a kind of translation. So, and you know that you have to communicate it to the reader, whether you are going to publish it or not. But you have to make it understandable, and you have to actually bridge the gap. And in the process, you feel what is common between the text you are creating and the text that you are experiencing. and also learn new things and the similarities and the differences. So for example, there was a very good famous poet, Fehmida Riaz, who I requested to translate an Arabic novel by Najib Mahfouz into Urdu. So she said that I had the English translation. So she said that she would want the Arabic original also. So I said, but you don't know Arabic. She said, anyway, you get me the Arabic. And it was a very good decision because she didn't know the Arabic grammar. But there are a lot of words. First of all, we have Arabic and Urdu have the same script. So the transliteration of names was quite different in English because the protagonist used to be called Doria, D-O-R-I-A. So, which in the original was Durriya. Now, Durriya comes from Dur, which is a pearl. So that takes you in a totally different direction. So the other thing was that there was a sentence in the English translation that the coffin was brought into the courtyard. So if you translate coffin from English, you would say taboot. I mean, coffin would be the wooden box, which is not our thing, which is not it does not belong to our culture. The Muslim culture or the Hindu culture also for that matter. But in the Arabic, the word was mayyat. The mayyat angan mein lai gayi. You know, mayyat is a very culturally rich word. So you, it's a process in which you are always negotiating with the cultural difference on the one hand and the linguistic distance on the other hand.
True.
So, and you have to invent your own way for every translation, because then a third thing also enters, which is the personal style of the original author. So, which you cannot predict. So, you have to be faithful to all these aspects. Which Absolutely. Is a difficult thing, but it's a very enjoyable and enriching experience.
You call yourself an artist. On what ground? Drown, baby, drown. Download the one-page Spotlight app for artists.
Kathy, would you like to add to this?
Ajmal has said pretty much all that I wanted to say, also with his own specific examples, which I'm not familiar with. So thank you for telling us about that. For me, honestly, you know, it's been translation is like meditation, and I face these issues, but I wouldn't call them difficulties because they're challenges really, and that is what makes the whole process worthwhile, isn't it? I mean, if they're just everything is very simple and if everything is easy to take across the linguistic cultural bridge, then what are you there for? So, you know, I really enjoy these challenges that translation throws up, and as Ajmal said, it's everything, you know, you don't have a book of rules to follow there, or you know, kind of solutions offered to you. Every time you face a tricky situation, you have to invent your own solution and come up with it, and that is what is so interesting about it. Sometimes there is so much beauty in the original word that although there is an equivalent, or if there isn't one, you invent an equivalent, but still you're not satisfied with it, and somehow You just feel, you know, sometimes I find the original word to be so beautiful that despite it having an equivalent in this language, I just don't feel like taking it, you know, translating it. So sometimes what I do is I retain the original and kind of bring it in such a way that it doesn't remain opaque by being in the original, so that its meaning is clear. I mean, I use certain techniques. I figure out what to do, how to bring in the meaning there, but keep it there because I think the sound of that word itself is very beautiful and it ought to remain. So things like that, you know, and this may not happen all the time because if I start doing it, then the text becomes, it begins to sag with too many unknown words. So you have to make sure that it's not done too frequently and things like that. And, you know, while translating poetry, for instance, if the original is a lyrical poem, if it has rhyme and meter and all of that, just recreating the meaning is not enough. You also have to make sure that it scans and it's got that rhythm and everything. And for that, you have to take certain liberties, because if you stick very strictly to the original, then you don't get that affect. So, you know, there are some liberties, some choices you have to make at every step, where you may think you're compromising a little bit on the meaning, but that is fine because you're making sure the rhythm is created. And in that, you're actually creating a new poem in itself. And maybe there is some small mismatch in the interpretation. But I think every reading is an interpretation to begin with. So as a translator, if you come in there, you have to kind of be responsible, take responsibility for it and stand up and do it. Maybe towards the end, I don't know if we have time for that. If towards the end, we are allowed to read something that we have translated. I would like to read one such poem where I think I've taken the liberties. So I wouldn't call it a translation in the truest sense. I would call it an inspired retelling. And this is one poem which many people have found very, very daunting. From what I know, it's never been translated. Whatever people have tried to do, it's annotation. Just explain the meaning of it. But even for that, it's a very difficult poem. So what I've done is I've broken the shackle. I haven't bothered too much about annotation and whatever. And what I did was take it in, see what it felt to me, and bring it back out in English. So I will do it towards the end. Let's first talk about the same question.
Sanket, would you like to add to this? What are your difficulties that you have been facing?
Sure. So one thing that I really wanted to add to this entire panel is the fact that, according to me, translation is the most legitimate way of discovering new words and inventing your own words. Like, for example, you know, let me really give you an example. You have something called as jaywalking in English, right? But there's no Marathi equivalent to that, right? In the same way, when it comes to Marathi language, there's an entire process when you're doing a puja in your house. And what you do is you take the thali of puja and you kind of, you know, you kind of circumcircle it, you know, around the god. Now, there's no real English word for that, but there is a word in Marathi for that. So I think, you know, as a translator, when Maitri said that, you know, you can take that liberty. This is the liberty that you actually take, that you can invent a word, you can discover a word. And that word stands for the collective experience of both the poet and the translator. So I completely agree with Maitri in that sense. You know, translation obviously is not just a process which is without, you know, it's more also a process of within, because what really happens is you only translate those pieces that truly disturb you, that truly makes you restless. And it truly, you know, you read those poems and you understand that, hey, you know what, something like this does not exist in the culture that I come from. Something like this does not, isn't present in my literary tradition. And that's what I want to do. As a translator, I want to bring that text, those ideas, those ideal, that part of a culture that my, you know, that my language isn't yet exposed to. And that's what I want to bring over here. So what I did was, when I was translating Rochelle's work, or Vinita Agarwal's poems, or Mihir Chitre's poems, or Suhit's work, or, you know, whatever, all of these contemporary poets, what I really understood was the fact that everyone, apart from having a unique voice, has a unique perspective about looking at life. Just the way Ajmal Saab very rightly said that, you know, it's not just about two languages are two different ways of looking at life. So, you know, that perspective really, really takes you in, and you really understand that, hey, this is something that if I have learned something from this, I'm sure that many readers who read Marathi poetry will definitely learn something from you know, this. And that's the reason why you try getting them in your language as well. So obviously at the end of the session, I will also read, you know, one poem that I truly felt very dear to me. And once again, it was a very, very enjoyable process. See, what I really believe is translation has to be given the exact equal amount of respect and equal amount of showcase and spotlight as much as you give it to an original poem. Because trust me, when you are a translator, you're not just a translator. You are that poet plus you're your own translator. Vis-a-vis when you're writing, you know, your pieces, as in your original pieces, you're just that one poet and you just have your own perspective to kind of pen down. But when you're translating, you're looking at so many different things. You're looking at bringing those words into your curriculum, into your syntax. You're looking at bringing that idea into your language. You're looking at how can I make this piece more accessible? How can I make this piece more readable, more lovable? And at the same time, you know, translating the sound of that poetry, translating the idea, the value of that poetry as well. So, you know, I think being a translator is far more difficult than just being a poet, because you employ practicality along with emotion and language.
I'd like to know how you translated jaywalking and aarti.
So you know what, I still haven't found a word for jaywalking. So I did go through a lot of dictionaries, and I did my comparative studies, but I could never really come up with a word for jaywalking, and as a result of which I had to keep that poem aside. So once again, I mean, you know, unless and until you get that word right, you can't really proceed. And then once again, you know, it's a translator's responsibility, as you very rightly said, that, you know, you have to take that responsibility and you have to do that. But at the same time, you can't, you know, jaywalking as a word is so subtle. You can't, you know, Marathi does not have that provision for such a word. And English does not have a provision for something which is known as Ovarna in Marathi. And Mr. Ajmal Sahib very rightly said that Mayat is a very culturally rich word. Yes. Mayat has the same meaning and has the same intonation in Marathi, which is known as Mait. So it's so similar, like, you know, all languages are just a fraction of a, you know, fraction of a meter away from each other when it comes to translation. And you obviously realize how close you are to your counterpart when you start translating the word.
Yeah.
I think one point that has been raised very significantly and again is that translation should be considered original work. It should be given the same importance.
Absolutely.
That an original work gets. What I feel is that for most of history, that was the case, because there was hardly any original work. When Kalidas was writing Shakuntala, Abhijan Shakuntalam, he was actually taking a story from Mahabharata and he was retelling it. Ramayana has been retold so many times, including Ramcharitmanas, which is today, you know, the most read book across the Hindi belt. So this is, I mean, all, and he never, nobody ever questions that, is this a true translation of Valmiki, or has he, you know, so those questions never arise. It is only in the modern age where we are, even Shakespeare for that matter, Dante for that matter, Shakespeare took plots from everywhere. Romeo and Juliet was a known story. He just told it from a different perspective. He helped people empathize with Romeo and Juliet, where while others are telling, don't fall in love, you will die. That was the message of the original Romeo and Juliet. So that is something I think the translator and as an original author, all of us are constantly engaged with. Ajmal Sahab, you mentioned that all translations are bad translations. I remember there was a panel during Bangalore Poetry Festival where Jerry Pinto was speaking about his process of translating. And he said a very beautiful thing, that translating is like transferring perfume from one bottle to another. Translating is like transferring perfume from one bottle to another. There will always be a loss, but at least as optimists, we can see that bottle half full. You know that at least some of it has been done. We have tried to stay as true to the original work as we could, and you know, make that cultural translation also possible. So I think it also comes down to the translator, as you have rightly pointed out. Now I think one question that bothers, I mean, as translators and as writers, I'm all of us.
Can I clarify something?
Yes, Ajmal.
I never said that every translation is a bad translation. I said every translation is a failed translation. Because you can't achieve that. I mean, if something can be described in the exact same way, it has to use exact same words. So, which is not possible if you're writing in another language. So, it always leaves something to be desired. So, which is a good thing. I mean, there is always room for improvement. There is always a place for a new translation. That is why one translation can be very different from the other translation. As Maitri was saying, that's when reading itself is interpreting, and then if one translator reads the poem, it will be different from the other translation, other translator's view. So this is what I meant, actually.
I completely agree with you. What you said, that every translation is a failed translation. It is, I mean, at the end of the day. But we can only do as much as we can, right? And give our best to it. So now next question is, of course, we are now towards the end of our session. We are running short on time. One question as readers, as not as translators, but as readers of people translating others' work. What are some of the good works of translation you have read? Let's start with Sanket this time.
One of the most important things that I have come across in this entire process of translation was, there's a very eminent Marathi poet called Sadanand Rege. And Sadanand Rege wasn't just a prolific poet because he had a beautiful voice of his own, but also because he was singularly responsible for translating most of English and French poets. So he was responsible for translating Mandelstam. He was responsible for translating Camus, Sartre. He was also responsible for translating Lord Byron. He was also responsible for translating Sylvia Plath. So all of these beautiful and really, really unique voices are something which Sadanand Rege brought to the core. So obviously I'm thoroughly inspired by this poet translator. The other poet translator is obviously Dilip Chitre, who has translated Tukaram's Abhang. Says Tuka is his English text. Once again, extremely prolific poet. Wonderful translator as well, who's really, really, you know, brought so much richness to the whole Marathi texture of writing. So these are two, three poets which I truly, truly adore when it comes to translation. And I think almost every single poet that I've come across, even in recent times, they've all been amazing translators as well. So although they have found their own voices and their own language, they've also been fairly translating a lot of, you know, world literature, so to say, and they've tried to bring it in Marathi.
Maitri, would you like to share what are some of the good works?
You know, I mean, before we talk about all the big names and sound very important by saying we know these people, so the biggest, you know, the earliest work of translation was Asterix Comics. For me, because it's originally written in French, and as Indians, I don't think many people know, I mean, unless you belong to some very big urban spaces. I mean, I come from a small town or village practically, so French is entirely out of bounds. But English is there, and you know, I'm so grateful that these amazing comics were translated into English, that I had access to it since an early age, and it's actually one of my biggest influences. So Asterix Comics, I'm actually quite excited to say that was one work of, and it's excellent translation, because there it's as a you know, it's as comics, it's full of puns, and translating puns is, I think, one of the biggest challenges for any translator. So, and to carry that meaning and that joke and that humor, sometimes you have to reinvent the whole thing. Of course, you have to abandon the original and bring a new one in it, which suits the context, because the drawings are the same. So Anthea Bell and Derek Hockridge were the translators whom I read Asterix comics. That's amazing. And also, I mean, as with the years, I've been reading more all the European literature, Spanish literature, South American literature. We read is mostly in English, isn't it? So it's all got to be good works of translation. Wisława Szymborska is one of my favorite poets. Yeah. And her works, of course, Polish works, I've read in English translation. And they speak to me, so I know that those are excellent works of translation. Two of her more important translators are Claire Kavanagh and Stanislaw Baranczak, who was himself a poet. So these are some names I'd like to mention.
Ajmal Saab, would you like to share? And I know you would have a very long list.
All of us, when we start reading, we read a lot of translations. And when, as you said very rightly, when you go through our classics, they always, even if when they are not translations, they claim their text to be translated from some other text. It used to be considered a good thing. So like 1001 Nights and all these classical stories.
We find the same stories in Jataka, in Panchatantra and Aesop fables written across culture.
Yeah, and generally they don't, nobody knows who wrote them.
Yeah.
So, so I read a lot of stuff in children's books, which were adaptations or abridgments of translated works. But I can think of one novel which was translated into Urdu. It was Harper Lee's novel To Kill a Mockingbird. It was translated by a fiction writer, Altaf Fatima, who was from Lucknow and who migrated to Lahore and lived her life there. It was called Nagme Ka Qatl. So that was a very, I found it a very good translation. And a lot of American writing was translated as a project into Urdu. I don't know whether such a project existed in other languages, but there was a Franklin Foundation which commissioned these translations. And it was amazing because Moby Dick was translated. I mean, a lot of Red Badge of Courage was translated into Urdu. A lot of American fiction and poetry, Leaves of Grass was translated into Urdu. So this was actually part of that Franklin project. And I'm still amazed there was someone at the helm of it who knew which fiction writer or which author will be able to translate which text. And they were generally very good translations. And the choice of translators was something which still amazes me. So this To Kill a Mockingbird was a translation which I want to mention here.
If I had to mention a few, I think A.K. Ramanujan's translation of Kannada Vachan Kavya, phenomenal work. I mean, I would have never been able to get acquainted to such insane, amazing poetry if not A.K. Ramanujan had done such translations. Also, there is a lesser known translator in Hindi, Vairam Singh. He has translated phenomenal Russian novels. A lot of Dostoevsky, Tolstoy is translated into Hindi by Vairam Singh, Professor Vairam Singh. He's very old now, lives in Himachal. He was a professor at JNU and worked like exhaustively just translating. So some of the greatest Russian literature exists in Hindi because of this one man. Baba Nagarjun did a lot of translation of Sanskrit literature into Hindi, including Vidyapati, Maithili literature into Hindi, Sanskrit literature. He translated Meghdoot to Hindi. His translation of Jayadev is also pretty good. So I really like what Baba Nagarjun did. I like the fact that he was a phakkad kavi, just lived on the, you know, like a poor man, never had anything, never thought of writing theory, literary criticism, anything, but was such a great Sanskrit scholar and, you know, just translated besides his own writing of poetry. The only other thing he wrote was more poetry in the form of translation. So I really like that fact, the kind of, you know, translation he chose to do. I'm not a great fan of Harivansh Rai Bachchan as a poet, but I really like the translations that he has done. He has translated some of Shakespeare's work, including, I think, Hamlet or Macbeth. One of these two books was translated. I think both, maybe. I'm not too sure. Seeing that work, and it was very well received. I have Omar Khayyam's translation by Harivansh Rai Bachchan, which is again really well done. He has actually preserved the meter and the rhythm of the originals in while translating them. So yeah, I think that, and of course the modern poets, Mangalesh Dabral, Ashok Vajpayee, Rajesh Joshi, Sudhir Ranjan Singh, Arun Kamal, almost everyone is a very, you know, hardworking translator besides being a good poet. So a lot of them do a lot of translations, which is, so Szymborska, a lot of other modern poets, Adonis, we get to read their work in Hindi thanks to this generation of poets who has kind of paved way for the next generation, which we now belong to, where we get exposure to such great work. Which is one of your dream book or writer you dream to translate in future? And please share that one writer you'd like to translate in life. So we'll start with Ajmal Sahab. I think he would have already done it, but we'd still like to hear that.
No, actually, it is a deferred dream. I had planned to translate that Kannada novel by Bulwar Mohammad Kunihi in collaboration with Maitri. It hasn't worked out as yet, but I'm sure it will be done one day. And I'll be haunting her for this. And we'll do it. It's a long novel, and Bulwar, we met Bulwar also separately, and he thought that it's a crazy idea, because it is about 1100 pages.
Wow.
He was not interested, and he said that even when you drop this idea, we should keep meeting, because I said, yeah, we will keep meeting, and we will translate it as well. So one day we'll translate it, me and Maitri.
Maitri, would you like to share what is your dream project?
Yeah, I would just say it's the same thing as Ajmal. To be honest, I don't really have a dream project for translation. It's an everyday thing, you know, so once in a while, I read an amazing poem and I just have to put aside everything and do it. If it touches me deeply, I have to sit down and do it. I don't even care whether or not it gets published. I just do it. So it's like that. So I haven't really thought of a book or a novel, whatever, to do. But as Ajmal said, that plan we had didn't work out. We were also kind of trying to, we had applied for a grant, for a fellowship to be able to do that, because it meant having to set aside several months just for it. But that didn't work out. So, you know, we also had to think about managing our finances and our own personal lives and all of that. But that didn't work out. But I'm hoping it will happen, like Ajmal said, one day. But I'd like to add that meeting Bulwar Sahab was such an amazing experience. Such a wonderful person, not just as a writer. He's such a very sweet, very welcoming person. I regret that we haven't been able to translate his novel, but just meeting him was itself it was like a dream come true, to be honest.
Yeah. Okay, what about you?
So what I've really realized throughout all this time is the fact that a lot of Marathi poets, are still untranslated. And what really comes to us is just the tip of the iceberg. So one of my dream projects that I really want to put into action is basically translating 100 of the finest Marathi poets into English. And that's something that, it is very much on the horizon of doing. So, that's one of those things that I truly want to do and truly want to accomplish.
Oh, that's a very big project that you have undertaken. But in fact, this reminds me, Dharmveer Bharti had done a project where he had translated poems from every country. He had translated a couple of poems from every country and created an anthology in Hindi.
Wonderful.
So, one book with all the cultures. So something, this is a kind of a reversal, an entire culture in a single language. So yeah.
Absolutely.
I also don't have a dream project. I would like to translate more Hindi poets into English, but I'm not sure how good I am at it. I have to still figure that out. I would really, if there is one thing I can probably do, and this is a suggestion that came from Arun Kamal, a very dear and a very respected Hindi poet. When he read my translation of Basho and Isa and Buffon's poetry, Japanese work, he was quite impressed, and he suggested that such work should happen in Hindi. I have, in my essays, I was able to connect Japan and India, and even the West for that matter, in because poetry does not have a language, right? Poetry is a language in itself. It doesn't matter if it is Japanese poetry or European poetry. The basics, the foundations remain the same. So I was able to bring those things together. He said something like that should happen with Shakespeare also. So far, the work is only limited to translation, but not a deep dive into Shakespeare from the Indian standpoint, from the subcontinental perspective. So that would be something that I would really like to do. I don't know which book, maybe Hamlet, maybe, I'm not sure which book, but currently I'm quite fascinated by Hamlet, of course, all of us are. So yeah, maybe at a later stage, I would like to translate and work, write something about Hamlet, which really adds to my language. That is a long-term, I'm sure I'll not be I'll be capable of doing it in the next 10 or 15 years, but at a later point in life, I would like to take something up of this game.
Yeah. Wonderful. that in itself is also quite a substantial dream.
Yeah, it is. And now that it was asked, I could think of it. I mean, I also never really had a dream of any thoughts. I also take it as it comes, most just like all of you. Yeah. Okay. Now let's, we are at the end of the session. I think we have already shot over time. But let's do one thing. Let's read a little bit of our own work, one poem or a couple of poems, and then we'll end this session. It will be nice to hear the translations, and if you want to share the original, even that is good. So we'll start with Maitri, because I think all of us are very fascinated by how she was able to capture the rhythm and the way she has, done a creative retelling. So
thanks. Before I read that poem, I'll read one poem, the one I spoke about just now. But before that, just to demonstrate the point that I made earlier, where I said I retain certain words and try to kind of ease them in to suit the context, I just want to read a small passage from the novel I translated. It's actually a humorous little situation there. That whole novel is rife with humor, and most of it is linguistic humor. It comes from the way people speak. So that was a challenge, and that was what made it very interesting. And this novel is set in a region in Karnataka, which belonged to the old Bombay state. So there's a lot of Marathi also spoken there. And I come from that space. So I come from the same area, northern Karnataka. So, it felt very, very familiar. And there's a lot of Marathi and Urdu mixed in our spoken language. And that novel is written in that language. It's not the standard literary Mysore Kannada that's used in most literature. So in this, there is a situation where this young man has eloped with a girl, and he's come back home after a few days. He runs away with her, gets married to her, then brings her back to his village. And the way, I mean, he goes to his employer, he's working as a kind of a servant in somebody's house, and he goes there because that's the only place he lives with his young bride, and his master is very angry with him and is shouting at him, and he's a Marathi speaker, so he speaks and he yells at him, and there's all these curses, you know, and I thought it was so rich and fascinating, and I didn't want to lose the effect it was creating by, you know, saying, oh, he called him a rascal and it ended there. So some, I mean, it was a whole passage was full of curses, but I retained some of them, and this is what I did, and I'd like to read that out for you.
Just to add to this, you know, curses in any language seems really rich to the person who gives them. So
yeah, absolutely. So I've retained some of them, and this is what I've done. It starts like this. Lucha lafang yield. Paji badmash, halkat, fazal, labad. Having emptied the Marathi vocabulary in calling him a lout, wastrel, rascal, and scoundrel, he continued with a few choice curses in broken Kannada about his mother's questionable morals and his diet, which he insinuated was catered to by the wrong end of a cow, and warned him against stepping into the house. People set aside their important tasks to gather for the show. So that's how I, you know, retained some of them and also kind of eased it in.
Wonderful.
Thanks. And this is a poem that I was telling you about. It's by Dara Bendre, who's one of Karnataka's most celebrated poets. And it's a poem called Naku Tanti, which means four strings. And it's very deep, very philosophical, kind of difficult to understand. So, and it's very rhythmic also. I mean, most of his poems were songs. So what I've done is, like I said, I didn't worry too much about recreating whatever lexical equivalents there. I just let that poem sink in. I sat with it and let it get inside me. And then I rewrote it with the same rhyme scheme and meter and everything. And this is how it's come on. So which is why I want to say it's an inspired retelling. Four strings. As cowing hows coming together in cowed crowds, you and I, cowering in the song of creation, are but creators of utter joy. What are birthing pangs for earthlings as me and you, when all of life hangs in the throes of what we do? Our four-pronged verses, thronged with resonance, as the quartet traverses, quaternary strings with elegance. Smitten or bitten we are by this pleasure bug, where boundlessness by far undoes limits with a shrug. What is the wall, the backrest, that our world leans on, but birth and nourishment at the breast, and upon it a reflection? Under the star's gaze that sharp rain hurls, a pearl into open oysters. O my son, now are you slain? Then call out fate's twin daughters, of Pa and Ma the world's child. It's mother's egg and father's egging, as his yoke and her yoke is tied. I, their infant love, come legging, you and I and creation's sigh. Plucking on the spirit nigh are all the four strings, where the core of a being lies. It is infused with the humming of the mounted, indentured God, the glorious general of all creation, made archer by the nod, joining together meaning and motion and goals that the soul's eyes trod. So, yeah, it is rather complex. And it's full of alliteration. So that also was a kind of a constraint, but I think I managed to recreate it in some way.
Wow. Ajmal ji, would you like to share next?
First, I would add to the dream thing. Actually, dream is something very ordinary for me. I mean, it's an everyday thing that you travel from one dream to another. This is how you live your life. So I would read two short poems that I translated from the Hebrew literature. And there is a Hebrew poet, Yehuda Amichai. So, of course, I translated it from English and I would read it in Urdu. So, let me see if it conveys something. It is called Bail Ghar Lautta Hai. बैल रिंग में अपने दिन भर के काम के बाद घर लौटता है अपने फाइटरों के साथ कॉफी पीकर और अपने दुरुस्त पते के साथ उनके लिए एक रुका छोड़कर और सुर्ख रुमाल रखने की जगह बताकर तलवार उसकी अकड़ी हुई गर्दन में गड़ी हुई है और गड़ी रहती है अब वो अपने घर में है और अपनी भारी यहूदी आंखें लिए अपने बिस्तर पर बैठा है उसे मालूम है गोश्त में उतरते हुए तलवार को भी अजियत होती है अगले जन्म में वो एक तलवार होगा अजियत बाकी रहेगी उसका रुका दरवाजा खुला है अगर ना हो तो चाबी दरी के नीचे होगी वो शाम की मेहरबानी से वाकिफ है सच्ची मेहरबानी से इंजील में उसे पाक जानवरों में शामिल किया गया है वो हलाल गोश्त है और अपनी जुगाली करता है उसका दिल भी सीन की तरह दोशाखा और बीच से चिरा हुआ है बाहर उसके सीने पर बाल उगाए फटी हुई दरी के धागों जैसे तो दिस इज वन पोएम द बुल रिटर्न्स इट्स कॉल्ड इन इंग्लिश और द अदर इज अ shorter poem, it is called High Heel Shoes. Unchi Edi ke Joote. Zameen ne kai baar jawab diya, andar a jao. Jab tum unchi edi ke jooton se khatkhatati, sadak paar kar rahi thi. Usne kai baar kaha, andar a jao. Lekin tumne suna nahi.
Wow, wow. Ye dusri kavita bhi Yehuda Ahmad Zai ki thi.
ये दोनों यहूदा अमिखाई की पोएम्स ओरिजिनली रिटन इन हिब्रू व्हिच आई ट्रांसलेटेड फ्रॉम इंग्लिश
संकेत आप सुनाइए
सो आई एम गोना रीड दिस वन पोएम बाय रोशेल पोर्टर विद हुम आई एम आल्सो कमिंग अप विद माय फर्स्ट बुक ऑफ क्रॉस ट्रांसलेशन सो वेयर आई हैव ट्रांसलेटेड 40 ऑफ हर पोएम्स एंड शी हैज ट्रांसलेटेड 40 ऑफ माइन So this has been a simultaneous translation process for the two of us. So I'm going to read this one wonderful poem by her called Lava. So I'll read that poem first in English and then I'll kind of tell you, I'll recite that in Marathi as well. Just one thing, and I've always been telling this to all the people, before I recite or I read, that you really do not have to understand the intricacies and the syntax of a particular language when you're listening to it. You have to feel that particular language, and you would know when you start feeling it that all the experiences that you're talking about, through that poetry or through a particular text, feels so much like your own. So I'll read this poem first by Rochelle, and then I'll read my translation. Lava. The body detonates long before it actually does. Like motherhood happens when you think of a child, and love when you yearn before the lover crosses the crosshair of sight. My body is bending at its curves, molten lava in a smelting ring. Cells, each cell detonating where you last touched. Old cells, as they go, are telling the new ones of the way you will touch me. Rough love, seeking through old diary pages a new broken song. A stanza, forever eluding, the tune elongating, overlap. My body is receiving her swell and blossom. She's awakening in a thousand breaths. All our letters sent kissed to you. Just the mere thought of you is a thunder trapped in the solar plexus. States of privilege are the states of being loved. Immigration is home. Your body is my home. Your lips my envelope. Letters are teeth, message of souls. My body is awakening like a river under rain, torrid. the woman awakening in the woman in the jungle. After this comes Amazon, Athena, Venus. My body is molting to the magma of breath, the silence that holds the worlds of our longing. So this was the original English text. Now I'll read the Marathi translation. Lava. Shariracha visphot hoto, sharirahi karnyadhi. Jasa matrutva apsukach yeta, baalacha manat vicharala ki. Kivha salsalta utkanthena prem dakun yeta, khup adhich, priyakarachi nazrecha katakshat gaath padnyadhi. Maza deha jhuklay swatacha vakra reshet, वितळला आहे तुझ्या बोटातल्या अंगठीसारखा. प्रत्येक कणाचा स्फोट होतो ज्याला तू शेवटचा स्पर्शून गेला होतास. जुन्या पेशी विरघळताना नव्या पेशींना सांगतात तुझ्या उंच सखल प्रणयाच्या गोष्टी. जशी जुन्या डायरीतली पानं शोधतात नवीन गाण्याची तुटक चाल ज्यातलं एक कडवं कायमच निसटलेलं असत, ज्याची चाल पसरते आपल्या दोघांच्या असण्यावर. माझं अंग विस्तारत आणि मोहरत एकाच वेळ, नव्याने जन्म घेत असंख्य श्वासांमधून, जशी तुझ्या गंधानं लिंपलेली तुझी पत्र. तुझा विचार म्हणजे इंद्रियांमध्ये अडकलेली कडाडणारी एक बीज. ऐश्वर्यात जगणं म्हणजेच तुझ्या प्रेमात पडणं इतकं समान झालंय. स्थलांतर म्हणजे नव घरपण. तुझा देह म्हणजेच माझं घर. तुझे ओठ म्हणजे मला आलेलं पत्र. तुझी अक्षर दातांच्या चिन्हांसारखी तुझ्या आत्म्याचा निरोप सांगतात. माझा देह जागा होतो नव्याने भर पावसातल्या नदीसारखा, जसा एका स्त्रीमधून एका नवीन आदिम स्त्रीचा जन्म व्हावा. ह्यापुढे जन्म घ्यावा अमेझॉन, अथिना किंवा विनसचा. पण आता माझा देह वितळतोय तुझ्या श्वासांच्या ज्वालामुखी आणि एक दीर्घ शांतता कवेत घेते आपल्या दोन विश्वांची तळमळ. आपल्या दोन विश्वांचे
कारण. व्हेरी नाईस. आय विल रीड अ कपल ऑफ पोएम्स बाय बाशो बुसॉन अँड शिकी. सो दीज आर ऑल व्हेरी नॉट शिकी सॉरी बाशो बुसॉन अँड इसा. दीज आर ऑल व्हेरी स्मॉल थ्री लाईन हायकू. सो आय जस्ट रीड अ कपल. दिस इज बाय बाशो. घिरते बादल चांद ताकने वालों को मिलता आराम. सूखी घास गर्म हवा के नीचे दबी हुई. गहरे पतझड़ में इल्ली करती तितली होने का इंतजार. जागो तितली भोर हुई है जाना है दूर. साधुओं के पदचाप गाढ़े बर्फ से निचोड़ती मीठा पानी. तो इस तरह की इनकी कविता है. थके थकी टांगों पर बैठा कौवा पतझड़ की रात. कपल बुसॉन की कुछ कविताएं. चलते फिरते घर में रहता घोंघा. जुगनू छोड़ना मच्छरदानी के अंदर कितना मजा. चावल का खाली बर्तन पैंदे पर चोट कोयल की आवाज. बेर तोड़ते हुए मेरे झुर्रीदार हाथों से भी आती खुशबू. कागज का छाता सुराखों से छनकर गिरती चांद की रोशनी. इस तरह की सुंदर सुंदर कविताएं बुसॉन की भी है और कुछ ईसा की. उम्र पूछे जाने पर नए किमोनो पहने बच्चे ने दिखाई पांच उंगलियां. गिरते हुए फूल से छलकती कल की बारिश. किसान की बीवी रोपती बिरवे. बिरवे यानी सैपलिंग्स. किसान की बीवी रोपती बिरवे रोते बच्चे की ओर. प्रतिबिंबित पतंगे की पुतली में पहाड़. सोई तितली मेरे घुटने पर बैठो आराम करो. तो इस तरह की कविताएं हैं इसमें. मतलब इन तीनों कवियों की मैंने लगभग 80 हाइकू ट्रांसलेट किए हैं. इट वॉज अ ब्यूटिफुल जर्नी. एक और कविता जो मैंने आज शुरू में बताया था ना कि ईसा माफ कीजिए शी लीजी जो चाइनीज पोएट है फॉक्सकॉन वर्कर थे 23 साल की उम्र में उन्होंने आत्महत्या कर ली थी. उनकी एक छोटी सी कविता है. ये उनकी आखिरी कविता है. आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू शेयर दैट विथ यू. द पोइम इज कॉल्ड मैंने लोहे का चांद निगल लिया. मैंने लोहे का चांद निगल लिया, वे इसे कील कहते हैं. मैंने इस औद्योगिक नाले को, इन बेरोजगारी के दस्तावेजों को निगल लिया. मशीनों की बंदगी करते युवा समय से पहले मरते हैं. मैंने शोर शराबे और बेबसी को निगल लिया. मैंने पैदल पुलों को, जंग लगी जिंदगी को निगल लिया. बस अब और नहीं निगल सकता. जो निगला है वो अब मेरे गले से फूट कर मेरे पूर्वजों की जमीन पर फैल रहा है, एक शर्मनाक कविता बनकर.
वाह वाह वाह, क्या बात है, वाह क्या बात है.
We realize that we haven't, we are not alone as translators. There is a much larger, you know, group of people, much larger, you know, we are co-patriots in this journey. And so we need to, you know, keep supporting and keep learning from each other. And right. I hope we live in a world where every good work gets translated and the recognition it deserves. So true, thank you so much for being a part of this session. Thank you so much, Sanket. Thank you so much, Ajman. Thank you so much.
You call yourself an artist. On what ground? Drown, baby, drown. Just because you're a square peg in a round hole doesn't make you better than the crowd. Drown, baby, drown. It's lonely at the top, lonelier still at the bottom, because the artist cannot be the sole audience. Drown, baby, drown. Visit spike.com and rent a power bank at the nearest location.